Welcome to HECTV's live interactive program that's part of St. Louis.
The whole production is pulled together.
This is going to be a steel bridge.
The way the cockpit is designed.
The highest rated green building in the world.
Welcome to HECTV Live. Welcome to HECTV Live. Hi, everybody. I'm Tim Gore, your host for our program. And today we're at the Center of Creative Arts in St. Louis, Missouri for our Inside the Artist Studio Little Dancer program. The Little Dancer is a performance that Coca performed in December, and they've actually been doing it for a number of years now. It's an original dance piece inspired by Degas' famous statuette and a variety of different art pieces put together by the fine and fabulous Amy Shears. Amy, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you, Tim. We're pleased to be here and be a part of this.
Give everybody a little bit of information about Coca.
Sure. Coca is the Center of Creative Arts in St. Louis, Missouri. It's a multidisciplinary art center, and we have classes and camps and performances in a variety of disciplines: dance, theater, voice, visual art, and some culinary work in the summer as well. We've got classes from beginner to professional and all kinds of ages.
Oh, good. I was about to ask that. All kind of ages. So I could come and learn how to tango?
We're going to bring in some tango, a little hip-hop. Looks like your thing. Yes.
Yeah, okay. I won't worry. I won't necessarily be enrolling in the hip-hop, but maybe a little ballroom dance would be good for me. There As always, go. HECTV Live is interactive. We're going to be joined by some interactive schools from across the country via video conference. To each of you, I'll be calling for your questions throughout the program. Please keep your microphones muted until we are actually connecting with you. In addition, for all of you who are watching over the television or over the web, we want your questions and comments as well. You can send them to us at live@hectv.org. That's live@hectv.org. We got quite a few this morning, and I'm looking forward to the ones we get this afternoon. So, Amy, the program is The Little Dancer, inspired by Degas' famous statuette. Talk a little bit about the origins of where this idea came in your head.
Sure. We got a request back in 2006 from the St. Louis Art Museum to do a full-length story ballet using the statue as kind of the inspiration for the piece. So we did a little bit of research, a big artistic team and myself, and we determined that the story, the true story of the dancer, her name is Marie, and she was a famous dancer with the Paris Opera. Although she actually didn't get to be a famous dancer on all the stages of the world as she wished. That being a sad story, we didn't want to tell that story. So our story is about an artist who needs his next inspiration. So he sees this statue, he knows the story of the little girl, Marie, and he decides that he's going to fulfill her dream of becoming a famous dancer and dancing through other pieces of art, the only way he knows how to fulfill her dream. So with that, he picks a model, and they go on through their project. She dances in the art as it comes alive.
And the art changes every year, and so do individual pieces. It's not necessarily the exact same performance each year.
It is different every year with a different theme, and there are some that we repeat, because they're a bit of audience favorites and great for the dancers to work through. And every year we do go through the collection and pick some new pieces.
And the performance that you did in December of this year was all dealing with American artists, correct?
Correct. It was an American tour. And so all the artwork was by our own homegrown American artists.
So today you'll have the chance not only to see live dance, but also some videotaped excerpts from the performances in December, and of course the artwork that inspired the different pieces. Don't forget, your questions can be sent to us at live@hectv.org. We've got an audience joining us here at the Center of Creative Arts, and we welcome your questions as well. Just go right on over to that microphone anytime you have one. We look forward to those. We're going to start with a videotaped excerpt, which is actually pretty close to the beginning of the actual piece. Now, you mentioned it's a story ballet. Does that mean, like, throughout the entire performance, we're just going to see traditional balletic movement?
No, there's a lot of different styles of dance that we'll get to see, which makes The Little Dancer really a unique opportunity for the audience to see a wide breadth of movement. And so the waltz that we will see that begins it is pretty typical of what would have been at the Paris Opera Ballet. So it's a traditional piece. And from that, the artist within our show is watching and observing to pick a model for his piece.
Well, let's let the audience see that. Okay. Here it is, the segment entitled The Waltz.
Thank you.
So the performance begins with a waltz, a rather traditional dance.
Correct.
But throughout the course of the entire performance, we're going to be taken through different periods of time, different periods of dance, different emotional feel, that kind of thing?
There will be a wide range of energies, a wide range of dance styles, and some traditional dance, as well as some more contemporary stuff.
You mentioned the fact that it's called a story ballet. For those of our TV audience and anybody here who doesn't know what that means, what does that mean?
That means simply it tells a story. Obviously, in dance, though, we don't tell a story like you would usually in the theater, where you have lines and things of that sort, so the audience can hear what you're saying. So in dance and in ballet, it's a special art form called pantomime. And so the artist uses a lot of that to tell the story, to get the emotion across, to understand the story that happens. So our story is about this artist and this young girl that he picks and their journey through this project. And as she grows and develops and finds her love for dance, and he then feels fulfilled that he's helped her reach her dreams.
And where do the dancers come from? Are they all students here at COCA?
They are all students here at COCA. We audition them once a year, so they audition in August. And through that audition process, we cast them and kind of fit where they might need a little bit of room to grow, to go with a little bit of where we know their talent is, so they'll be cast appropriately. And for those that are repeat members, we make sure we really vary their education.
Very cool. I want to welcome all our interactive schools who I understand now are in the Morned Bridge. Thanks very much for joining us. I'm going to begin to ask you some questions as we bring up a painting that inspired the next piece of work that you're going to see performed live here. You're going to notice that this is an image of a magnolia, and interestingly enough, that's exactly what this next piece we're going to see is called, right? Magnolia.
Exactly. Right.
I want to go to our students at Creative Arts High School in Camden, New Jersey, and I'll be asking this question of the other students as well, but Creative Arts, as you guys look at this painting, what kind of dance do you see coming out being inspired by this? What kind of colors, what kind of music do you think might be inspired by a painting that looks like this magnolia? What are you thinking might be possible? Creative Arts, take it away and say hello to everybody.
Classical. Classical.
Very much a classical, romantic look to it. The colors bring that out as well. Thanks, Camden Creative. We'll come back to you guys for more questions. Be thinking about the questions you want to ask the dancers after you see the piece. Let's go to Cream Family School in Camden, New Jersey as well. When you look at this painting, do you guys see something different? A certain kind of music come to mind?
Jazz music.
Jazz.
Interesting. Maybe jazz music could be something out of it. Very cool. I like that idea. We're really glad you guys are connected with us. We look forward to your questions. When you sat down to think about this piece, you didn't choreograph it yourself, right? Someone else did.
Correct.
And we'll have the chance to meet who that choreographer is. But when you work with someone like that, you just say, okay, here's the picture, run with it?
Not exactly. They might like that. But what I do is I look at the entire series, the entire show and all the different pieces. And this piece has actually been a piece of art that I have wanted to put into the show every year we've done it. And this year it did afford itself to be done. It called, in my mind, a classical piece, a little more formal in nature. And this year we've got a cast that's appropriate for it, with the gentlemen that we've got, the ladies and their level and ability, and they're doing a special dance called the pas de deux.
The pas de deux.
Pas de deux. Two people dancing together, making it look like one movement, and the ladies are in pointe shoes, and I think you'll enjoy it.
Wonderful. Pay attention to the costumes and the colors there. Compare that to the painting, and then we welcome your questions afterwards. We'll get off stage, and now it's Magnolia.
Thank you.
Oh, Amy, thank you very much. We're going to go to your student questions in a minute, but first I want to invite the choreographer out. Christine Cardell, who choreographed that piece, please come out and join us.
Hello.
Well, I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you for inviting me.
Give the audience and the students joining us an idea about what it means to choreograph a piece. When you looked at that painting of a magnolia, what did you think, and how then did you want to translate that into movement?
Well, the picture was just so beautiful that I wanted to do it justice. The magnolia is so grandiose. I wanted the tutus to be elaborate and beautiful and jeweled. And classical ballet is passed down from teacher to student, so the artwork lives on forever and ever, just like the ballet goes on forever and ever. So they were a perfect combination to go together.
And in terms of time frame, between, here I get the commission, so to speak, and now we're performing, what is the time frame for putting a piece together, and does it change, like, as you go through the rehearsal process?
Definitely. I listen to the music in my car a lot, and over and over and over, and the movements just kind of develop in my head listening to the music. As I start working with the dancers, sometimes the picture that develops in your head is not the same one with real life people. So it does morph and change, and sometimes better, many times better.
Well, let's see what questions our students have. And we're going to bring a couple of the dancers out as well, so I'll invite them to join us. I believe it's going to be Jocelyn and Darcy who both perform as the little dancer in different productions. I want to start by going to Charles Frazier and the folks at Creative Arts High School. We'll do two questions from Creative Arts, and then we'll go to Cream Family School for two questions, and then we'll check on our Tennessee folks again. So Creative Arts, take it away. Questions for the dancers or for Christine or for Amy?
What made you look at the background color, like the satin color in the painting, instead of the magnolia itself?
The magnolia, I saw the leaves as the petals of the tutu. So therefore, we had the white flat tutus that have the big circle. The colors in this are the other background picture in the artwork.
And who makes your costumes? They're made from scratch in this instance, or no?
These are made from scratch. We have a fabulous costumer, and Miss Jean, as we all know and love her, she designed them and then helped us to build them, and they're absolutely gorgeous.
Very good. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to Creative Arts for another question. Take it away.
Is the tutu shorter than it normally is?
Let's talk about the two different tutus, so to speak. Sure. Is one shorter than the one normally is? Talk a little bit about yours.
Well, this is a platter tutu. And this one, you can't move as much as you can in this one. And it kind of makes partnering harder, but these are, yeah. I don't know. They're really pretty.
And Jocelyn, from your perspective, what's it like to dance in that one instead? Since you dance in both.
This one is easier to dance in because it's less stiff than that one.
Well, and one of the things I noticed is that as the gentlemen were standing behind you, the whole idea of holding and turning and everything, it's like space really matters. I mean, this thing doesn't like give or anything.
No, it doesn't.
It's like a nice starched piece attacking your body as it spins around at you.
They had to, within the rehearsal process, actually put the tutus on quite often within rehearsals. So once you put on a costume, the dance changes.
Well,
you've got to work through it.
Definitely. Well, from a theatrical perspective as well, feel different as a dancer in this costume and what you're going to do with it than your body might feel in this one?
I think it does. It kind of sets the mood. If you're in that one, I think it's more playful, but this is more refined and classical.
Okay. Let's go to Cream Family School in Camden. A couple of questions from you. Take it away.
This is for the dancers. What inspired y'all to actually to start dancing, or made y'all think about like dancing and stuff?
Well, it was kind of my family, because I have an older sister, and she started dancing before me, and I always saw her on stage, and I just wanted to be a part of that, and I just kept dancing ever since.
Jocelyn?
Well, when I was little, like, I tried doing other things, like ice skating, I guess, and I never really found that satisfying, and dance, like, made me happy, and every time I'm on stage, it just brightens up my day and stuff, so that's why I keep dancing.
Very cool. Kareem, another question from you. Keep it there, Camden. What's your second question?
What inspired you to name the dance Magnolia?
Because obviously you could have chosen to go a different name, even though that's what the painting's about. Why so?
Because the magnolia is so central in the artwork, and the tutus are so central in the dance itself. So I thought magnolia was the obvious choice.
And these are kind of like magnolia blossoms.
Yes, definitely.
Coming out. And if you've ever seen them on a magnolia tree, quite impressive. And these are quite impressive tutus. Amy, I'll let these folks exit as we talk a little bit about what's going to happen next, because the next piece that we're going to see via videotape from the December performances is very different in structure, in style, in tone, everything.
It definitely is. It created a high, if you will, within the show order. So the next piece is a piece of art called Homage to the Square, Wandering. It is a bunch of sequential squares, different colors, yellow and green. And the cast is...
Oh, I'll stop you there.
Oh, we're going to stop there?
I'll stop you dramatically there for a moment of pause. And I'm going to go to the student groups. And when you guys look at this picture, which is obviously very different than the painting of the magnolia that we just saw, when you look at this image, this work, what kind of dance do you think might pop out of this painting? What kind of music do you think might pop out of this painting? Cream Family School, what do you guys think?
Contemporary.
And I can certainly see that because that art piece is very contemporary. The artist is, off the top of your head, can you remember? I'm putting you on the spot, Amy.
You are, and I forget.
But it is a fairly contemporary piece.
It is a contemporary piece.
And so,
Yosef Albers.
Albers.
I believe that is correct.
And it is a contemporary piece. And when this one was put together, I want you guys to notice the colors of what the dancers are wearing and the shapes of the outfits that they're wearing and how they link to the painting that you see. And then in terms of the music, which is certainly catchy, where did you get it from? How do you go about deciding this is the music for this particular painting?
Sure. This painting, it caused me a little struggle at first. And I went back to my artistic team, and we knew the kind of piece we wanted. We knew the age group of the kids we were going to use. And thank goodness for iTunes that we could just hear 30 seconds of many different songs. And when I heard this one, it sold me.
Well, let's look at it, and then we'll welcome your interactive questions throughout. Homage to the Square.
Thank you.
Amy, you choreographed that piece.
Correct.
And before you start to talk about that, I want to see what questions our students have, and then we'll talk about this particular piece. So we're going to go to Creative Arts again. What's your reaction to what you just saw in terms of the music, the dance, the painting all going together? And what questions might you have for Amy about the choreography of that particular piece? Creative Arts, take it away.
Can you demonstrate how to properly turn a ballerina?
Are you asking Amy to do a turn on point, or about a dancer to do a point turn, a turn on point?
Yeah, we'd actually like to see her show you how to properly partner the ballerina.
We all like you, Charles. So we'll go for that. Okay. So now.
Okay.
I'm totally willing to look bizarre in public.
Give it for Tim.
Okay. So thank you. It's my understanding that balance really matters here, so I may be in trouble from the get-go. I lack anything on top to keep me balanced. But show me what happens.
Oh, well, I'm in heels.
Okay.
But first of all, you have to make one shape.
Okay.
Usually put your foot by your knee. We'll go parallel.
Like this?
Make easy. Yes.
Okay.
And it has to balance in one shape. Hold your arms out. It gives you more balance. Ah, see? Ah. Good job, Tim.
Thank you. Is this now, all? Thank you.
Yes,
thank you. That's good for me.
Now, in order to turn,
oh, good Lord.
You just need a little momentum. We're in
uh-huh.
the physics class now. So a little momentum and then a spot, which means that your head's going to spin quickly. So put your foot down.
Okay.
Put it behind you a little bit. Bend your knees. And you're just going to push and go. Very good. There we go. Ah, beautiful.
Thank you.
Fabulous. Good.
Creative Arts, I hope you enjoyed that experience, because the morning program didn't get it, and I'm not sure I could do it a lot. I did recently have lunch, so I'm not sure what we want to go with. That's great, though, in terms of that, because I have friends who dance, and that whole concept of turning fast and quickly, but it is the idea that you're trained on a spot, right? That's why I don't get dizzy
Correct.
And don't get nauseous.
Correct. Absolutely.
Okay. Creative Arts, another question or comment from you guys?
Did the straightness of the arms and the legs represent the square in the painting?
A great specific thing to notice, and that was one of the questions I had for you as well. Talk about that, because I love that.
Yes, there is obviously a lot of horizontal and vertical lines within the choreography, obviously just replicating the shape of the square. And so typically for myself as a choreographer, I don't often use straight lines, so it was a bit of a challenge for me. So I was excited to kind of go that route. And so yes, there was a lot of horizontal lines, a lot of vertical lines, and just a lot of playfulness in the whole choreography. Their relationship with the little dancer as well brought a lot of playfulness together.
And I want to pick up on the playfulness idea of it.
Sure.
Because obviously it was way more playful than the Magnolia piece. But
right.
the whole, like, you know, this little jiggity jog movement.
Yeah, you are going to dance this whole show. Fabulous.
I won't dance, don't ask me, but that's a different show, isn't it? I mean, there's a lot of ways you could choose to do that kick.
Right.
And I notice in a lot of instances the kick's not going straight back.
Right.
It's going out to the side.
Little twisted, hit that edge of your box, if you will.
Okay, so
show
then,
that shape.
And obviously when you think about ballet, everybody agrees automatically it's very precise. It looks so precise.
Correct.
But this dance is more playful. How important
right.
is it, I mean, is it just as precise though in the sense that, you know, this is the way my fingers need to be as I do this kind of movement and that kind of thing? The precision
right.
is still the same even though it looks more playful?
There are elements of precision and there are elements where we ask the dancers to bring themselves to it.
Okay.
To actually go ahead and be as big as they want to be, which keeps it a creative endeavor for the artist as well. And so for the dancers, you know, there are times where you all need to be together, and there's a certain count to be there. But some of that playfulness in there, it was a little more free. Your leg to the side, how much to the side is a little bit up to you.
Okay. The next painting we're going to bring up is going to be leading us into our next live performance, and so I want to bring up this painting but not say anything about it, because first of all I want our students to respond to it as you look at it. It's obviously this one individual woman, and I'm going to go to Cream Family School first in Camden, New Jersey. Cream, as you look at this painting, who do you think this woman is? What might be the story behind this woman? What potentially is the kind of music and or dance you think would be coming from a painting inspired by this woman? Cream, what are your thoughts?
Maybe the photo maybe kind of represents the little dancer, but not as a statue.
Very cool. Creative Arts High School, let's go to you guys. What are your ideas about this painting?
I think it's a lady about to step into doing a salsa or something.
Ah, so, and indeed, we are going to have a dance that is cultural in nature here.
Right.
A dance with a bit of a flair, like the salsa is a dance with flair. If I remember correct, the salsa is a South American, is it Brazilian
correct.
Perhaps,
yep.
dance? And we're going to do a different dance with flair, but instead of a salsa, it's going to be?
A tango.
And what do the students need to understand about tango as a dance form, or as a tango in terms of movement, to help them notice what's going on in the way you've arranged things here on stage for these dancers?
Sure. Obviously, you can see in the image as well. So in the painting, there's a lot of strength in this woman. And she's got a bit of an attitude. And so the relationship between the tango dancers and the little dancer, and how they get her to grow a little bit, and just the energy. It's a high-energy piece.
And the tango's all about attitude, isn't it?
It is all about attitude.
Well, let's look at some of that attitude with the performers who are going to give this that performance live now, and then you'll have a chance to ask them your questions. It's tango. Ladies, I'm not going to let you get away. I want to invite all of you back on because I'm sure our students are going to have questions for you about the tango and about that particular piece. So you guys come right on in front of myself and Amy. You guys are way more important at this moment in time than we are. Go all the way to the pink line so you can be in your light. We've gotten a variety of email questions, and I want to ask one before we go to Creative Arts again for some of their questions and Cream Family. And one of the questions dealt with transitions. The question was about what are the transitions between paintings like? How do they handle the little dancer moving from one to another during the actual show?
Sure. So the transitions were a unique complication as we have done this piece, and it has changed every year. And we are finally at a place that we think it makes sense for the storyline. So we typically will have, over here on the side of the stage, an artist studio built. So all the pantomime at the beginning of the story is told through over there. This model of the little dancer obviously ends and begins each piece by taking the pose of the little dancer, right? And so within that, we page back over to the artist studio, and he gets his next idea. So he pantomimes. He uses some props, and he works through his next idea. On our psych back here, so projected up on the screen, we've decided that we actually project up the name of the art as well as the artist, so that it kind of ties the story together, so that the audience knows where we're going next. And halfway through that idea in his head, the little dancer starts to come alive. Mm. And with that, at the time the music changes and the lights shift, all of the artwork is already in their place. So then we're ready to begin. So it just keeps transitioning between each one in a very similar fashion.
Okay, this is a very, very different dance. And all of you, my understanding is you've all been the little dancer at some point in your career as well. All right, who would like to talk about the difference between dancing this kind of dance and little dancer? What do you like or dislike about it, the comparison between?
Being the little dancer, you're on stage the entire show, and you really have to carry everything and be able to switch immediately between all the different roles. Doing this dance is one of my favorite ones to perform. It's just so, like, sassy and fun, and you get to put your own energy into it. But it's also fun being the little dancer in this part because you get to dance with the tango dancers a bunch, so.
And in terms of tango, tango is usually a dance with two, right?
Correct.
It's a man and woman dance.
Right.
So you've inspired the ideas of it here, and a lot of the, like, the flair with the skirt and that kind of thing. How fun is it to do this?
It's so much fun. This is actually my favorite piece from the show. And just the costumes with the red shoes, it all comes to life as, like, you're the paint or the pick girl in the picture.
Let's talk a little bit about your red shoes, because you ladies are wearing toe shoes, right? Point shoes today?
Yes.
And so some folks might have a question about point shoes themselves. Why are they all so square on the end, and what do you guys end up standing on? What is all that? How's that? What's fill that in for me.
The shoes are actually made out of glue, so it's hardened glue and some layers of fabric. And they hurt sometimes, but you get used to it after a while.
Yeah, you say that after wearing them a long period of time. And no, we will not be putting Tim in point shoes for today's experience. Yours are obviously white, but can you do, besides the fact that those colors different, do you do anything for it that makes it your own in the sense that, you know, you stretch it, you manipulate it, you scratch it up or whatever, so it becomes really comfortable for you in the same way like a baseball player would work his glove?
Mm-hmm. We break in our point shoes, so we might, like, take it and bend it at the arch where our arch bends, and we might, like, break down the box a little bit and stuff.
Okay. Very cool. Very cool. Amy, anything else about the tango as a piece and the idea of, like, why three, for example? I mean, I could have had six or eight or whatever. Why three, and why did that number seem to come to you or whoever choreographed the piece?
This piece is actually choreographed by a lady named Christine O'Neill, who is currently teaching at Washington University and has danced professionally in New York and things. And she saw one image being a central focus and just being flanked by two other dancers to kind of fill out the stage. We think the volume of dancers might have detracted from some of just the one person image
Okay. That
is on the piece.
Our interactive schools are back, and I want to go back to them again to see if you got questions about the tango dance you just saw. So I'll start with Creative for one question, and then I'll go to Cream Family School. Creative, a question about the tango?
Was this dance done in counts of three, six, or four?
It was the groups of three.
Right.
And talk a little bit about the pattern on the floor, the square-like look or the way they moved around the floor.
Right. There was obviously a draw to the little dancer. Uh-huh. She stood downstage a whole lot. So downstage here. And because of the attitude that image brought about, throughout all of the choreography of the show, the way that the artwork relates to the little dancer, the way that they become aware of her, the playfulness from the lemon tree, from the square piece, to the kind of a little more enticing, you know, drawing her in that the tango, it's what the image speaks. What the painting speaks, the piece of art speaks to the choreographer. And we like to vary it for the little dancer and to keep the story alive.
Okay. And Cream Family School, a question from you guys about the tango.
When you go to school and then you have to go to practice, is it tiring?
It is very tiring, and it's also hard because we have to get home from a long day of school and we're tired and we have to complete our homework. Then we also have to come to dance, but coming to dance is always fun and, like, it re-energizes you.
Great. Thanks very much, ladies.
Great.
I'll let you exit, and we'll begin to talk a little bit about the next piece that we're going to go through. Let's bring up the next artwork so you can see what's inspired the next piece that's going to be performed live here. This piece is entitled Stomp, and looking at the artwork, again, I'm going to go to our two schools. Creative Arts, what does this picture make you think of? How many people do you think might be involved in this dance number? What kind of dance is going to be here? Do you think it'll be different than what you've seen before? What are your thoughts, Creative Arts?
Yeah, it looks like a male piece, actually.
Yeah, like it'll be four males in the dance,
working hard or something.
Think of that painting. Good thought, Creative. Cream Family School, what about ideas you have based on this painting?
Actually, it looked like this painting will be based on maybe hip-hop.
Oh, okay. Hip-hop? It is definitely going to be a different kind of dance than we just saw for sure. Lively, and is going to include props and any number of things that create noise and sound. That's going to be a little bit different than everything else we've seen so far. And I don't think we'll give them much more than that. Shall we just let that?
Keep it a surprise.
But we welcome your questions afterwards, and we're going to meet the whole cast afterwards, so you can ask all sorts of questions of them. So let's give you Stomp. Thank you all very, very much. I'll ask the entire cast to come out now and take some seats there on the edge of the stage, and as they do so, I'm going to go to each of our student groups because we want to go to a series of questions now you might have about the piece you just saw, your response to that piece. Do you think it went along with the painting and the ideas you had about it being a little more contemporary and those kinds of things, and questions you might have for the different members of the Little Dancer cast. Let's go to Creative Arts. We'll do two questions from there, and then we'll go to Cream for a couple of questions and see what our time's like at that point. Creative Arts, take it away.
Did you take this choreography from stunt directly?
No, we did not. This was created by one of our tap instructors, actually. So she used the rhythm and the rhythm tap that we teach here at COCA and kind of incorporated that within all of the typical stomp movement. The image, the painting, obviously brought to mind the trash cans and the sticks and the pieces of wood. And so she incorporated all that together.
Very cool. Creative Arts, another question from you.
Questions. How challenging was it to use the props? And additionally, who thought of the costume idea?
Let's start over here on my right. Who's got the, go ahead, sir. Introduce yourself.
Okay, hello. My name is John Roberts. And to answer your question, the props were very hard to use because of all the rhythms that we got and all the different beats and tempos that we had to go along with the music. But just working over it and going over it became easier and easier each day. And the costumes were some were basically homemade. We brought in pieces of clothing from our homes that fit and went along with the painting.
Very cool. Great question, Creative Arts. Let's go to Cream Family. Cream Family, a couple of questions from you.
With the music that I heard, it sounded like a little bit of jazz, but like a little bit of hip-hop at that. Was it better dancing to both of them than just one?
Oh, okay. In terms of dancing to that music and that piece, what's that like? How does that make you feel? Who over here would like to answer that question? And they continue to pass the microphone. Oh, sure, go for it. You are. In terms of that music and that piece, did you like dancing to it? What's your reaction to dancing to that? I mean, it's a couple of different kinds of things are going on during it.
Hi, I'm Shakira Wade, and I enjoyed dancing to the rhythm of that of the piece because I'm more of like hip-hop modern dancer, but I love ballet. So I enjoyed working with the more modern beats and rhythms that the piece offered.
Okay, and this is a piece that we were talking about before, the difference in what seems to be precision and what may not be perceived as precision, because the ballet is all about precision. But as you guys work with these pieces, specifically the props, could someone over there talk about the need for precision here? Because obviously you don't want to whack each other with those things you're holding, amongst other things.
Yeah, my name is Claudia, and it's different from the precision in like ballet because you have to make sure you're on beat and all of your rhythms are the same. Whereas in ballet, you have to make sure, you know, your one foot is pointed to the back or your arm is in the right place. It's more rhythms and working with props.
Very good. Cream Family, a second question from you.
Is it easier to work with upbeat music than slow music?
That's an excellent question. Who would like to speak to it over here? Difference between working with upbeat or slow?
Well, they're very different. So I wouldn't say that one's harder or easier than the other. They require different kinds of strength and different amounts of strength depending on the piece.
Okay, very cool. I know we've only got about 6 minutes left, but I welcome more email questions from you guys. It's live at hectv.org. And just as we did for the morning program, Amy and I'll be spending some time to get responses out this afternoon too. So if you've got more questions, send them to us. But we want to give you a chance to also see the end of the performance of The Little Dancer with this pre-taped piece we had based called Chihuly, inspired by Chihuly's work. He's a glass artist who's really into different colors of glass. Anything you want the audience to know about this before we see this videotape excerpt?
It is just the finale.
All right, let's look at the finale and then we'll come back here for some final questions. Thank you. certainly a fantastic ending to the performance. I mean, those costumes are amazing. The flow, the color, and that Chihuly work is sensational.
It is. It's an amazing piece of work.
Amy, thank you so much. It's been fantastic working with you and everybody here at COCA.
Thank you, too.
We obviously want to thank Missouri Arts Council, who provides funding for Inside the Artist Studio. They give money for the Center of Creative Arts as well. And, of course, Mary Strauss, who's a big-time supporter of the Little Dancer specifically.
She has for many years. Absolutely. We appreciate her support as well as everybody.
Thank you to every member of the cast. And to our interactive schools for your questions. You make the program, so thanks for sending them in. If you've got some of them via email you haven't been able to ask so far, send them to us at live@hectv.org, and we'll answer them after the program. Tomorrow will be very different with HECTV Live. We'll be from the St. Louis Science Center for a program called Investigating Climate Change. Look forward to connecting with you there as well. Bye, everybody. Have a great day.